And they were killed. And police said if they had been wearing a seatbelt, they would have survived those accidents. The man's conscience couldn't take it anymore. Shakespeare's right. Conscience makes us all cowards. And this was true for David. And it's true for you and me too. When our sins bother us, and I can speak from this from my own personal experience, having fallen from Christ, I was a very sinful man. Our conscience, it makes cowards of all of us. And we don't know where to go. The world has no clue to find out where they get peace with their conscience. Many of the people that are in the psychiatric wards in our country are there because of guilt. Guilt over what they've done, and they haven't got a clue how to get rid of it. But David did. And that is, he said, blot out my iniquity. Cleanse me from my sin. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. That's forgiveness. That's forgiveness, isn't it? David wanted to be forgiven. In my first church, and I may have even used this illustration, but it is so good that some illustrations in Ryan art you can use twice. And she was a beautiful girl. Was not a member of our church, but she was just strikingly beautiful. Strikingly beautiful. Photogenic, you know, and everything. And I was teaching how to go out and witness, knock on doors and witness to the community. And she and about four other people from that church came over to be trained. And she was so good. I mean, she could lay before you. You would almost weep as you listened to her talk about God's love for you. Whenever we went to what we knew was going to be a very difficult house, we always sent Cherie because she could really present the gospel. But Luther says Satan is quick to pull the gospel out of our sight or out of our heart, and he torments us that. And this was true with her. And after everybody had gone home, she wanted to talk. And she had gotten divorced, and then she had married this man who was a member of the Lutheran church next door to us. And she said, I'll never forget, she said, Pastor, I never knew what the Bible said about adultery. If I did, I would have never, never gotten remarried again. She was, Satan had, and here was a lady who could really present the gospel. Satan had covered up the gospel for her. She was in great torment. Her husband was a fine man, fine Christian man. I would say that he was a good enough Christian man. He could be the husband of my daughter anytime. He was that fine of a Christian man. And so I said to her, well, Cherie, you've been married and you've been divorced, and therefore you're living in adultery because you're married to Connie. And she said, that's it. That's it. I'm just tormented day and night by that. I don't know what to do. If I'd known what I know now, I would have never gotten married, though he's a nice man. It's not worth it. Our conscience makes cowards out of us all the time. And so I wrote her name, and I asked her what her first husband was and wrote it on the chalkboard. And then I wrote her second husband, who was Connie. And I said, this is it, adultery. You're married to two men. That is it. That is it. I don't know what to do. And I said, well, do you believe that Jesus died for that sin? Yes. Yes, I do, she said. Well, I said, well, then what God does is he erases that sin and remembers it no more. He casts it from him as far as the east, the west, to the very depths of the ocean, never to be brought up again. When he forgives, it's gone. And she broke into tears of joy. That's what the gospel does. It fills us with joy. David was saying the same thing. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Forgiveness removes our sins from God's sight. This is a Lutheran insight again. And sad to say, not many Lutheran ministers preach that. But it is truth. Your sins are forgiven. That's why Jesus came. He died for all of your sins and rose again. Your sins are forgiven. You remember the story of Absalom in the Old Testament, David's son. And one of David's favorite sons. He had numerous wives, and apparently this one son was one of his favorite sons. Had a beautiful set of hair, like mine was when I first came here. And he used to have to cut it once a year because it got so heavy. Well, Absalom rebelled against his father and committed atrocious sins against his father. He was wanting to kill his very own father because he wanted to be king instead of David. And so he drove David out of Jerusalem in fear for his life. And yet when Joab and the rest of the army went back to fight, and you can understand this as a parent, no matter what and it's even more true of your grandchildren, isn't it? No matter how much they do, your heart is still with them, isn't it? If only they knew how much parents and grandparents love them. But they'll have to find that out when their parents and grandparents too. And David stood at the gate with these words, spare Absalom. Don't kill Absalom. Absalom got caught, you know, in the tree with his hair, and Joab came along and killed him, threw some darts in his heart and killed him, then buried him underneath some stones. The news was brought back to David, Absalom who had tried to kill David, Absalom who had spurned David's love, Absalom who tried to take away David's kingdom. He had done a lot of bad things and wanted to do even worse things to David. But when David heard it, we are told, the whole camp heard these words, oh, Absalom, Absalom. My son, Absalom. Would that it was I that died instead of you, oh, Absalom. My son, Absalom. Would that I died instead of you. Such was David's love for Absalom. Well, you and I are all Absaloms, aren't we? Yeah, we are. We have sinned greatly and grievously in our lives, defied God's word, rejected his laws, but he still loves us. Spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all. Jesus came for that very purpose. Though we were all Absaloms, God still loves us, and he still forgives us daily and richly. He forgives us of all of our sins. We can hear it in David's plea. Have mercy on me, O God. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. A tongue that sings and rejoices of Christ's righteousness proclaims the mercies of God, for God's mercy is greater than our sin. For where sin abounds, there is grace, and his mercy abounds all the more. And David says, because of his love and forgiveness, David said, my mouth shall show forth your praise. He was going to proclaim to the whole world what God had done for him, and he wasn't going to let anybody stop him. Christendom was a Saint Christendom. He was a church father back in the early 300s. Christendom means literally the man with the golden voice. The man with the golden voice. Apparently, he could make people cry at will. And he was a faithful proclaimer. There was an empress who was living an ungodly life, and Christendom denounced her sinful lifestyle. And the message got back to the empress, and she told him, you don't do that. And he sent the little messenger back with these words, you tell that empress, Christendom fears nothing but sin. He fears no one but sin. He was not going to shut up and stop proclaiming the mercies and the compassion that God has for his people. Teach me thy ways, a tongue that teaches the transgressors the way, the truth, and the life. That's what's to come forth from the pulpit. Jesus Christ today, yesterday, and forever, always the same. He is the truth. He is the way. He is the life. And if you believe that, if you truly believe that Jesus Christ alone is the way, the truth, and the life, then you know that he alone offers you forgiveness of your sins. He alone offers you eternal life. And that will change you. Your world outlook will be different from those who do not know Christ. What you believe in your heart, what you believe in your heart, and this is always true of everybody, what you believe in your heart will affect the way you live. What you believe in your heart will affect the way you live. Dr. Stephen Hawkins, do you know him, Ryan? Considered to be, Ryan, one of the most brilliant men of our time, next to Einstein. Next to Einstein. He is a professor over at the University of Cambridge in England. He has Lou Gehrig's disease, and so his muscles are just being eaten away by the disease, and now all he is a mind that thinks. He's able to think of great physics equations in his mind and then crudely type them out on a computer with his mouth. He is considered to be the smartest man in the world today, Stephen Hawking. But he does not believe there is a God. He does not believe there is a God. And when he said that, the world went ecstatic. Why, here they had the smartest man in the world, recognized as the smartest man in the world, confirming what they believe, there is no God. And if you don't believe there is a God, well, then it doesn't matter in the long run how you live. If there is no God, it doesn't matter what your lifestyle is. This past week, Dr. Stephen Hawkins, it was revealed that he flies over to the United States several times during the year with his little entourage of medical doctors and nurses and respirators. He flies over here, and you say, well, he's probably, you know, making a presentation at Harvard or out at Stanford or something like that. What you believe in your heart affects the way you live. It affects your actions. This man with supposedly the most brilliant mind comes several times each year to California to visit sex clubs. Sex clubs. His doctor and nurses, they take him into a little room, then they get him all prepped up, and then they are removed, and some girl goes in there by him. The world doesn't say that. But if you don't believe there is a God, and what you do believe, it affects the way you live. And he's a good example of it. David said, blot out my sins, have mercy upon me, O God. And that is the glorious wisdom. The fool has said there is no God. Paul would later write, in Christ, the whole deity dwelt in him bodily. Be wise. Don't let the world dictate to you how you're going to live or what you're going to believe, no matter how smart they may be, and no matter what the world says as far as smart as they were. You cling to Jesus Christ. You'll be like Luther. And he said, I have held in my hands many possessions. What I held ultimately slipped through my fingers. But what I gave Jesus is safe in his hands. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in true faith unto life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. We pray. O Lord Jesus, you alone are the way, the truth, and the life. There is no life apart from you. In you we find total and complete forgiveness of our sins. You have washed us. You have cleansed us. You have called us by name. And so we pray, give us the strength ever to live for you, to confess you before men. And we pray that Selah may ever be faithful in her stand and in her confession of the word, so that all that we give to you indeed shall remain. There is indeed life with you. In your precious name we pray. Amen. Heavenly Father, we pray for those who are sick, those who are on their beds of illness. We remember especially in our prayers, George Daniels and Luda Wallace and Caleb Teague. Be with them in this time of trial, pain, and suffering. Assure them that their sins are paid for in full. You have washed them, made them white as snow. You have cleansed them. You have called them to be your children. Give them the strength then ever to fight that good fight of faith, to finish the course and find that glorious crown of life which you have purchased for them. For we ask this in our Savior's blessed name. Amen. The Lord be with you and with thy spirit. We pray the prayer which our Savior has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Bless we the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you all.
Amen.
We will sing the first and last verse of the last hymn. First and last verse.